Want to buy a house?
Not everybody can achieve it.
That's true. And today, Labor unveiled a shiny $329 million plan to
help you achieve the great Australian dream of home ownership.
Called Help to Buy, the scheme would see a Labor government cover 30 to 40% of the purchase price. The buyer covers the rest with a minimum deposit of 2% and a mortgage. 10,000 places would be up for grabs each year. They'd be restricted to individuals earning up to 90k a year or couples earning a combined 120 grand.
The smaller deposit, smaller mortgage and smaller mortgage repayments.
Over time, the owner would be able to buy more of the property for themselves or leave the shared structure in place. That latter option would see the government take a share of any profit when the property is sold.
This scheme will make it easier for a number of first home buyers, and that's a good thing. I guess on the negative side, again, it's a policy that's going to add to demand in the market, and that may push up prices more generally.
More than 350,000 Aussies buy a home each year, so 10,000 places won't stretch far. The Coalition says its first homeowner grant and first home loan deposit schemes help a much greater number of people.
Our policies are proven to be working. We saw 160,000 new first homeowners into the Australian market last year.
This is in addition to what the government is proposing.
The number of first home loans has slumped this year, falling by 38.5% since January last year.
They're looking to make money out of this. They will have equity in your home. And as your equity goes up, they're going to keep it.
Our policy is about ensuring that Australians get to own their own home. You don't have Mr. Albanese at the kitchen table with you.
The Reserve Bank is expected to lift interest rates for the first time in a decade, as soon as this Tuesday. So has either party got the goods to get more Aussies their own home and keep them there?
It's not getting to the structural factors that are driving higher property prices, which is around our tax system, which is around those supply and planning side issues. It's fixing the symptom of the problem rather than the problem itself.
Well, Jason Clare is Labor's campaign spokesperson and shadow housing minister, and he joins us now. Jason.
G'day, Lisa.
Hi there. 10,000 spots a year won't go very far. Why do you want to cap it at such a low number?
Well, it's where you start. We want to help people who are on low incomes who otherwise would be renting for the rest of their life. That's why we've set it at people earning $90,000 or less. Let me give you an example of the sort of people that I think this will help. I met a woman named Angela last year who lives on the central coast of New South Wales. She works at the local canteen. Her husband, Aaron, is a carpenter. They want to buy a house for their three kids. They don't want to rent for the rest of their life. But they can't afford a mortgage for $900,000. They can afford a mortgage for $500,000 or $600,000, which got me thinking there must be a scheme that helps people like that to live in a home they own rather than renting for the rest of their life. And there are schemes like that. Here in Western Australia, where we launched the campaign today, they've been doing this for 30 years, and it's helped Aussies into their own home and owning their own home rather than paying rent for the rest of their life. That's why this is a good scheme, and that's why it's needed at a national level.
I know these sorts of schemes exist in parts of Australia already, also overseas.
Yeah.
I know in the UK, when the local authority owns a percentage of your house, you still have to rent that percentage of the property from them whilst living in it. Is that what would happen here?
No, it certainly won't, Hamish. Good question. You won't be paying rent to the government for the share of the house that the government has equity in. In the West Australian scheme here, as well as in the Victorian scheme, you don't pay rent on that part. The government will get its equity back when the house is sold, and it'll get its share of the capital gain. And that's why this will make money for taxpayers in the longer term. It's good because it helps people like Angela, that I mentioned before, to be able to buy a house and get a mortgage that they can afford to pay. But it's also good for taxpayers because, as we all know, investing in housing is a long-term investment. It's a good investment, and it will make money for taxpayers in the long term.
But if we're going to be, like, sharing a house together, like if you own... the Labor government owns a bit and I own a bit, like, what's the housemate situation? I mean, what is Anthony Albanese like as a housemate? In fact,
well, are you
from
talking
the Shadow Cabinet, who's the best housemate? Go on. Pick one.
Well, it depends. Are you talking last week when he had COVID or this week when he doesn't have COVID? I've got to tell you, he's a pretty neat dude. He makes the bed, so don't worry about that
at all.
Yeah. Hey, Come on, we're a close-knit team.
Jason, the reality is that your party actually had a policy last election that would have instantly made housing more affordable to abolish negative gearing. If you really cared about young people and home ownership, wouldn't you just do that again?
Well, we took it to two elections, actually, Veronica. We got beaten, we got walloped at those two elections. The problem still exists. It's got worse. House prices have gone up by 25%. Just in the last year alone. And it's young people that are being hit hard here, particularly young people on low incomes. If you go back to when Bob Hawke was the Prime Minister of Australia, about 60% of people in their 20s and 30s on low incomes owned a home. Now it's 28%. Now, that's a massive drop for the worst, and we're only going to feel the real impact of that when 20 and 30-year-olds today are 50 and 60 and they're retiring and they're still renting. So a policy like this can make a big difference here, but it's not the only thing we need to do. That's why we've promised to commit to set up a $10 billion Housing Australia Future Fund to build more affordable rental housing for nurses and aged care workers and cleaners and police closer to where they work, as well as build more social housing for homeless Aussies. There's a lot that we need to do here. Scott Morrison will tell you that it's all too hard or it's not his job or that the state government should do this. I think people are yearning for a bit of federal leadership here, and that's what we're offering with these policies.
Jason, we're at the halfway point in the federal election. I think a lot of Aussies still to make up their mind on all of this. I think some of the commentators are saying it's a choice between a guy a lot of people don't like and a guy a lot of people don't know. Can you give us, like, a simple reason why we might change government right now? I think a lot of us are just kind of confused.
Yeah, well, there's a choice between a better future and more of the same. Scott Morrison's not offering anything new.
But what's the better future? Like, what actually are you offering that's any better?
Let me give you a couple of examples, Hamish. Cheaper childcare. Childcare is really expensive. Anybody who has kids in childcare knows how expensive it is. When your child moves from childcare to primary school, it's like you get a pay rise. The changes we'll make to childcare will mean for a family that has a combined income of about 100 grand, they'll save about $1,600 a year. So that's a big saving. Cheaper electricity. Electricity is still way too expensive. The policies we're putting in place there will cut emissions, create jobs, and cut electricity bills significantly. We'll fix aged care. Aged care is a crisis. It's a nightmare at the moment. No one would want to put their mum and dad into aged care with what we've seen out of the Royal Commission. We'll fix that by making sure there's nurses in aged care 24 hours a day. But we've also got to do a bunch of other things, make housing cheaper. On top of that, we've got to do something about corruption in Canberra. Scott Morrison thinks corruption doesn't exist.
I'm pretty sure we said a quick pitch.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. Hamish, can I add one more in just for completeness' sake?
Very quickly, because we're out of time.
An Indigenous voice to Parliament.
Okay,
Indigenous Australians have been waiting too long for this. We should be recognising our Indigenous brothers and sisters in the Constitution and setting up a voice to Parliament. We will do that if we win this election.
Jason, can I just say, first of all, you've been very slick tonight. You know, you're always praised for your dazzling media performances. One of our producers told
Thanks,
us that you've apparently been dubbed the nickname Captain Handsome. Is that a nickname you started?
No, I think it's Scott Morrison who makes up his own nicknames. But I reckon Hamish should be a good candidate for Captain Handsome. He's a good-looking unit.
Maybe a future Prime Minister Handsome.
Flattery,
it'll get you everywhere, Jason. Well done. We'll have to leave it there. Jason, thanks for joining us this evening.
Thanks, guys. Thanks very much.